So we're going to wrap with two more focus areas. One is pacritinib, and there were two different studies that you had mentioned, you had presented actually on, you know, and what was so promising here is of course just serving a population that previously hasn't been, you know, allowed in clinical trials as much for some of these with severe thrombocytopenia. One though was for those with moderate to severe, and you were studying pacritinib, so there was a head-to-head comparison between that and ruxolitinib, and what did you find with that?
So to give some context, pacritinib is a JAK2 IRAK1 inhibitor, and it is a drug that has been in development for quite some time for myelofibrosis. And it is a drug that we learned early on is less myelosuppressive than, for example, ruxolitinib or fedratinib. And that kind of differentiated pacritinib from the pack. So when it was developed further along in the later phases of study, we started to look at patient populations that were perhaps unmet or vulnerable, like patients with low platelets that really didn't have the full option available to them, that patients who had adequate platelets. So it was quite obvious from the phase three studies called the PERSIST studies that pacritinib could be delivered to patients with low platelets at adequate doses and afford them spleen and symptom benefit where you really couldn't get that with the available drug ruxolitinib or even fedratinib for that matter. So we wanted to look and do a more deeper dive from the studies that were done previously, the phase three studies, looking at a comparison between specifically those patients and the control arm, what's called BAT, that got ruxolitinib, versus those patients who got pacritinib at 200 milligrams twice daily with platelet counts less than 50,000, this unmet need. And what we wanted to do was look specifically at the outcome measures, not at every patient who got it, but at the low platelets, comparing that rux to pacritinib. And what the analysis showed was that pacritinib, A, could be given at the full intended dose. You didn't have to modify the dose of pacritinib because you weren't getting the kind of cytopenias, low blood counts that would often force you to dose lower with ruxolitinib. And when you dose lower with ruxolitinib, you compromise your ability to afford the same degree of symptom and spleen benefit because you're using lower doses. So you could use full doses of pacritinib more frequently, and therefore you got much more significant spleen and symptom benefit compared to ruxolitinib. And this analysis really highlighted that specifically.
That's so good to hear. And so I just want to make sure I'm hearing correctly. When people have the low platelets or the thrombocytopenia, you know, sometimes with the ruxolitinib, they're not able to get the full dose, which might lower the efficacy. So the pacritinib, it was to see, can they be on the full dose and what the response was there. Is that right?
Right. It demonstrated that you can maintain full dose intensity with pacritinib. You don't have to modify the dose as you do with, for example, ruxolitinib. And ruxolitinib is a great drug. So by no means am I discoloring ruxolitinib as a less important JAK inhibitor. It was our first JAK inhibitor. It is a very potent and a very I would say it's still the standard of care drug for myelofibrosis. But when you look at this patient population, this low platelet, in which you can't really give adequate doses of ruxolitinib, it was reassuring to see that pacritinib could be given at its intended dose, and the spleen and symptom benefit was truly superior with pacritinib than ruxolitinib. So it really paints a really nice picture for a drug that's likely going to get approved.
There's a randomized open label phase three, and it's a novel drug. So these are for people who don't continue on ruxolitinib. And in that, you had mentioned the median overall survival there was 11 to 16 months. And so there is an urgent need for people who don't respond to a JAK inhibitor.
So that study is called the IMPACT-MF study. That's a randomized phase three study for patients who are refractory to a JAK inhibitor like ruxolitinib. So they don't have adequate spleen or symptom response and/or lost or had it and lost it. And those patients we know from five independent studies, unfortunately, have a bad outcome, and their survival can be marked somewhere between 12 and 15 months, let's say. And that's an urgent unmet need. We need non-JAK inhibitor therapies that can have a potential for disease course modification to try to extend the survival. So we did a randomized phase two study previously that's published this year, actually, in the Journal of Clinical Oncology called the EMBARK study. And that randomized MF patients who were relapsed refractory to a JAK inhibitor to Imetelstat. This is the drug we're talking about. It's a telomerase inhibitor at two different dose levels. And I'll just get to the bottom line. What was really exciting about that drug was not the spleen and symptom benefits like we see with JAK inhibitors, but it was the fact that we saw in the 9.4 milligram per kilogram arm, the survival of those patients who got the drug was 30 months, the median survival. And that's the other thing I want to just bring to the audience's attention. Be very careful when physicians or you read survivals. And when survivals are reported, they're reported as median. So I always warn patients, don't take that at face value. If someone says you have this disease and your median survival is 30 months, that does not mean you have 30 months to live. It just means if you take 100 people in your position, the 50th person lived to about 30 months. But it's a curve, and some patients can live much longer than that. So one has to just understand that it's a spectrum of survivals. In this study, we saw that with Imetelstat, we looked like we were extending the survival to 30 months, which was really exciting because it looked like we were doing something really beneficial, really at the core of the disease to improve the outcome, not just improve symptoms and spleen, which are important, but to improve the survival of patients. To prove that definitively, we set out to do this randomized phase three study of Imetelstat, the telomerase inhibitor, which is an IV drug every 3 weeks. Patients are randomized either to that drug or to best available therapy, which means the investigator, the physician, would choose what therapy they would give other than a JAK inhibitor to try to improve the outcomes of the patients with myelofibrosis after ruxolitinib failure. And the primary endpoint of that study is overall survival. Secondary endpoints are looking at spleen, symptom, and other key endpoints, but survival is the endpoint. And if that drug can improve survival in itself, that's fantastic. If that drug can help bridge patients and make them better transplant candidates, which is a more definitive curative option, that's fantastic. But what we're hopeful for is that this will change the natural history by changing the biology of the disease.
And what about the information on side effects with Imetelstat?
So the drug has a side effect of myelosuppression. It will drop in many cases the blood counts, which then rebound within the three-week period. So it's rare to have issues that lead to clinical consequences of those side effects, like infection or bleeding. And other than that, it's actually a pretty well-tolerated drug. It's not really associated with a lot of GI toxicity or other non-hematologic toxicities. It's mostly hematologic. Blood counts come down, they come up. The median exposure to the drug was about 8 cycles. So about 24 weeks or 6 months of treatment. So you didn't have to keep, it kind of goes back to what we were saying before about how often when we give MPN treatments, it's like indefinitely to maintain some sort of response until it stops working. In this case, the median was about 6 months, but yet the survival was 30 months. So patients were enjoying the benefit of that drug, even off therapy.
So they would get the infusion, it'd be about 6 months of the cycles. And then after, they enjoyed the benefit, so they didn't have to keep going.
Yeah, the benefit was durable. So it really spoke to the fact that the drug was probably doing something very profound at the origin of the disease that translated to benefits that endured beyond the actual exposure to the drug. So that even if you went on to receive a transplant, you went on to receive another JAK inhibitor, you went on to receive just supportive care, you were more likely to live longer than if you had not seen the drug.
That is such great news. And how much longer until, and you don't have a crystal ball, but until maybe patients could see something like this?
Well, you know, this trial is in its early stages. So one thing I would definitely encourage, and I do this at any meeting and with any patient conference, is if you're a patient with myelofibrosis or any MPN, I always urge patients to at least once seek the consultation of an MPN specialist at a major center that has access to trials and can give you options. And if the possibility and the potential ever exists, I would strongly encourage patients to to pursue the potential of a trial, because it's really the engagement and buy-in of the patient community that drives the success and the benefit that helps all patients. So if it weren't for the brave pioneers that really go on these trials, particularly in the early phases of studies, that really move the field forward, we would just be talking about things that sound like a good idea, but we would never know. So it's the patients that engage in trials that really get the drugs to the marketplace where the greater population can enjoy them. But for now, the access to the drug is limited to the clinical trial. So I would definitely encourage anyone who has MF to get a consultation, but to also be open-minded to the idea of a clinical trial. And this is one such clinical trial that I think is really worth paying attention to.
Yeah, so important, the people who participate and, help with the research. I know we're at time. Do you have any last message? I know we're not talking about cures, but we are talking about a lot of movement with different therapies. What's your last message to patients and caregivers?
I've been doing this for about 15 years, and I really hope that in my lifetime, in my career, you and I will have a meeting where we will talk about cures. You know, right now, cures are relegated to transplant, to bone marrow transplant, which is really a fraction of patients with myelofibrosis who get transplant. For all those patients who have essential thrombocythemia or polycythemia vera that live with chronic diseases, my hope for the future, and I don't mean the future like 50 years from now, I mean the future in the next 5, 10 plus years, is that we will have therapies that are really transformative, that really are able to put patients into remissions, even dare I say cures, and remove a lot of the anxiety, morbidity, and potential mortality of these diseases.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mascarenhas, for spending so much time with us today. And I look forward to our next conversation.
Likewise. Thanks for having me. I really appreciate it.
And for everyone who wants to tune into the full conversation, please go to thepatientstory.com, where you'll find human answers to your cancer questions.